Today's spoiler video is brought to you by Card Kingdom. Use the link below to pre-order your cards today. Hello everyone, it's Seth, probably better known as Saffron Olive, and it's time for another daily dose of Core Set 2020 spoilers, and we're actually nearing the end of Core Set 2020 spoiler season, I think, and I might be wrong that we might get the full set tomorrow, but either way, we're getting near the end, but today, we have a bunch of sweet new cards to talk about, thanks to some stuff over the weekend from the Mythic Championship, some new stuff today, so tons and tons of sweet, sweet new cards, which means we're gonna jump right into it, start talking about some Core Set 2020 cards. Before we do, a super quick reminder, if you haven't already, it would be so cool of you if you could take a second, click that subscribe button down at the bottom of your screen. It's a great way to support the channel and the site for free. So let's talk some Core Set 2020, starting with our last Planeswalker from the set, Vivien, Arkbow, Ranger. And this one, I think, is actually a pretty good one. So, 4 mana with triple green, which is a bit of a concern. That is a strict mana cost, but you get 4 loyalty. Plus 1, you can distribute 2 +1/+1 counters among creatures you control, and they gain trample until end of turn. So 2 counters on 1 creature, 1 counter on each of 2 creatures, giving them trample. -3, target creature you control deals damage equal to its power to target creature or planeswalker. And -5, you can tutor a creature you own from outside the game, which means your sideboard, similar to Karn, and put it into your hand. So Vivien, Arkbow, Ranger, this is a really powerful planeswalker. Basically, I think the best comparisons I can come up with is the +1, it's kind of a repeatable ranker. Like, you +1, if you put the 2 counters on the same creature, you're giving it +2 power, also bonus of +2 toughness, and giving it trample, which is really nice. The trample, I think, is huge. If it was just 2 +1/+1 counters, it would be fine, but it's much more exciting that it's also giving trample, which means your creature is going to be getting through for damage, attacking planeswalkers. The -3 is essentially Domri's Ambush without the extra +1/+1 counter, but still, essentially a fight-esque mechanic, except your creature doesn't take damage, and it hits planeswalkers, which, remember, we are in planeswalker.standard right now, so being able to hit planeswalkers is huge. And then the -5, it's basically a Living Wish. You can't get lands, but that's fine. In standard, you're mostly tutoring for creatures anyway, and one thing we have seen from Karn and from Mastermind's Acquisition is that tutoring from your sideboard, really, really powerful in general, and especially on Arena and Best of One standard, cards like Vivien and Karn, Mastermind's Acquisition, go way up in value because it gives you a way to actually kind of have a sideboard in a sideboardless format. So definitely gonna be even more powerful in Best of One, but I think it's good anyway. So Vivien is really scary. I think the most obvious home is some sort of like mono green stompy or gruel stompy deck. Just picture a curve where you're going like turn 1 Llanowar, turn 2 Steelleaf Champion or Gruul Spellbreaker, turn 3 Vivien, plusing, putting extra counters on your Steelleaf Champion, trampling over for like 7 damage, or your Gruul Spellbreaker getting in for 6 damage, or splitting them up with your Llanowar Elf. So very powerful starts, although as I mentioned before, triple green is asking a lot. You can't just play this in any random like 3 color deck because you're gonna have a hard time casting it, but we've seen all these strict mana costs. I bet we're gonna get more mono colored focus stuff in the future as we move through our next year of standard. So some sort of aggro stompy deck, that is the most likely home. Vivien does want creatures that come down before Vivien that you can put those counters on, start getting in damage. The other thing that is awesome about Vivien, and we touched on this a little bit, is the Living Wish ability. Being able to snag a creature from your sideboard Karn style, that opens up a lot of possibilities. You can get all these silver bullets that you might not want in your main deck, but from your sideboard can swing a matchup in your favor. If you need to blow up an artifact or enchantment or gain some life against mono red, you can say Knight of Autumn. Maybe you're struggling to get through the counters of a control deck, grab your Carnage Tyrant. Maybe your opponent's gonna go off with Command the Dreadhorde and reanimate a bunch of stuff. You can get Remorseful Cleric to fizzle the reanimation. So having access to cards that are good, but normally a little bit too narrow to be in your main deck, all the time in game one with Vivien Arkbow Ranger is very powerful. And remember, if you just stack a bunch of creatures in your sideboard, you have access to a lot of different options. And I think, in some sense, Vivien is even more powerful than Karn. Yes, the downside is Karn can come in and just tutor right away. Vivien can't do that. You gotta play it, you gotta plus once at least, and then you can tutor. But creatures more powerful than artifacts in Standard. In Modern, it might be reversed, but in Standard, I think you get way better options being able to snag creatures from your sideboard than you do with artifacts, because artifacts, while there's some okay ones, they can be a little hit or miss. If you've ever looked at a Karn sideboard, people play some pretty questionable cards to make Karn work. So, Vivien Arkbow Ranger, I expect this card to be very strong. Its mana cost will narrow the amount of decks that can play it, but in an aggressive deck that can consistently cast this, like, on turn 4, on turn 3 with the help of a mana dork, this is a super scary card in a lot of matchups, like against aggro decks, against control decks. Doesn't matter because of the negative 5, but it's especially great if you're trying to beat down and kill your opponent, because both of the first two abilities work well there, getting a blocker out of the way with the negative 3, sniping a planeswalker, and just getting in tons of damage. So a very powerful planeswalker coming in Corset 2020. Next on our list, we got our final Cavalier, Cavalier of Wind. So Cavalier of Wind, our blue Cavalier, 5 mana, 5/5 flying, triple blue. So again, restrictive converted mana cost to some extent. When it enters the battlefield, you essentially brainstorm, draw 3, put 2 cards from your hand back on top of your library. And then when it dies, you shuffle your library, and then you get to scry 2. So Cavalier of Wind, it's got decent stats. I was looking around, and a 5/5 flyer for 5, that's pretty above the curve. It's Demanding Dragon, it's Lyra stats, and that means Cavalier of Wind probably has a chance just based on its stats alone. It's not busted, it's not like Demanding Dragon is breaking the format or anything, but a 5/5 flyer, that's just 4 attacks to kill your opponent, and it gives you value right away with that Brainstorm ability, which means even if your opponent kills it, you're still getting something out of it. And Brainstorming, it's really powerful. It's a Legacy stable. Of course, 5 mana Brainstorm, not the same as a 1 mana Brainstorm, but still, it is a good way to improve your hand, especially if you can shuffle away the cards you don't want, which can be a little tricky in Standard, but we have scry lands. You can scry a bad card to the bottom. We have some shuffle effects, and Cavalier of Winds kind of does it on its own if it dies. Like, not that you're going to intentionally kill your 5/5 flyer to shuffle your library, but you can kind of have it be a real Brainstorm. If you play it, Brainstorm bad cards on top, it dies, shuffle away those bad cards, scry 2, which is close to drawing another card when it leaves the battlefield. I think my favorite home for Cavalier of Winds, and probably where it's most likely to be played in Standard, there's a couple of options. First is Primespeaker Vanifar. Cavalier of Winds is perfect for Primespeaker Vanifar. So the trick here is Primespeaker Vanifar can not only find Cavalier of Winds, and you can play it as like a one of, maybe a two of, something like that, but the Brainstorm ability is especially good with Primespeaker Vanifar, because in a Vanifar deck, one of the problems is you have to play this like birthing pod curve, and sometimes that means you have like 1 6 drop, maybe 2 6 drops, 1 7 drop, and if you draw that card naturally and you really want it in your deck to find with Primespeaker Vanifar, it's pretty painful. So Cavalier of Winds, apart from just generating card advantage, lets you put back other Primespeaker Vanifar targets that you really needed your deck to tutor out instead of having them stuck in your hand. So easy home there. Also, Yarok is coming, and Cavalier of Winds, when you boil it down to the very foundation, it draws you a card when it enters the battlefield. It is more than that, better than just drawing a card, but you end up with plus one card from the enter the battlefield trigger. With a Yarok out, you're doubling up that trigger, ending up plus 2 cards, and that's what Panharmonicon decks want, is card advantage generating enter the battlefield triggers. So another easy option there. My main question for Cavalier of Winds in Standard is, can it compete with the other 5 drops? We have some very powerful, mostly planeswalker 5 drops in our format, Teferis, Nissas. Are people going to play Cavalier of Winds over these planeswalkers in top tier competitive decks? And I don't know. I feel like one of the downsides of having so many powerful planeswalkers in Standard is cards like Cavalier of Winds, which might otherwise be like, okay, I need a 5 drop, generates card advantage right away. That might be in the conversation, just kind of get a little bit overwhelmed by planeswalkers, which can be so, so strong. So it might be that Cavalier of Winds is more of a niche card, rather than showing up as a multiple copy card in a bunch of different decks. It might just be in your Yarok deck or in your Prime Seeker Vanifar deck, because in other decks, like if you're playing Esper Control, you got Teferis. Do you really want Cavalier of Winds competing with Teferi in your 5-drop slot? Probably not. And the same is true of like Nissa and a bunch of other cards. So Cavalier, I think it's super sweet for specific archetypes. It is a very powerful card. Doing something right away is nice. Drawing cards, obviously great. But I think in standard at large, it might just rank a bit behind some of the great planeswalkers as far as what people are putting in their decks. Next up, we got Gargos, Vicious Warden, and this card is super spicy. 6 mana, 8/7 legendary Hydra. It has vigilance for some reason. It makes it so your Hydra spells cost 4 less to cast. 4 less to cast is an absurd price reduction on your Hydras. And then, whenever a creature you control becomes a target of the spell, it fights up to one creature you don't control. So, Gargos, it is big. 8/7 vigilance for 6, that's already fine. The most exciting part to me is that Hydra mana cost reduction. It kind of reminds me of Roisin Meander, which adds 4 mana for X spells often Hydras. Gargos though only works with Hydra, so you're not gonna Banefire someone, but you're getting a much bigger, better body, and it is a Hydra itself if you're gonna play Hydra Tribal. So just picture the powerful X spell Hydras. Picture in standard we have Hydroid Crosses. With a Gargos out, you're already starting with X of 4 if you play the blue and the green. So that's -4X, that's 2 more cards drawn, that's 2 more life gain, just for free, just for having a Gargos on the battlefield. So you can make your Hydroid Crosses massive. It's basically like having +4 mana. Apocalypse Hydra, Mistcutter Hydra, more modern or casual cards, but like Mistcutter Hydra, if you got Gargos out, you can cast it for a single green, and it'll be a 4/4, because you're getting 4X from Gargos. So it's a 4/4 for 1 with haste and pro blue. Apocalypse Hydra, kind of similar. If you can pay 3 mana with it, you're going to hit the X of 5 and more if you got Gargos out, which is going to make it a 10/10 for 3, which is absolutely insane. So in a Hydra deck, this is really powerful. The problem is, it's a little expensive. Like, you gotta get this down for 6 mana and then start casting your Hydras. But if you can ramp into it, you're gonna have a really explosive Hydra turn the turn after. We also just got Unbound Flourishing, which is like perfect for a Gargos deck. If you wanna build Gargos, like Commander, Gargos, Hydra, Tribal, and Modern, Unbound Flourishing is just perfect. You're getting that same scenario, the Mistcutter Hydra, the one green and X Hydra. Let's say you got Gargos and Unbound Flourishing out, you could cast it for 1 mana, a single green mana, you're going to get 4x from Gargos, and then it's going to double from Unbound Flourishing, so you're going to get a 1 mana 8/8 haste. And it's kind of like that with most of the Hydras. Like, think of all the cards you'll draw with Hydroid Crosses if you have the Gargos going on the battlefield. So super sweet combo there. The other thing is, it does give you a sort of protection, essentially. Like, if your opponent goes to kill one of your creatures, it gets target. Best case, you get to kill one of their creatures. So you are kind of protecting your team to some extent, and you can do some janky shenanigans where you target your creatures. Remember, it doesn't say when your creature is targeted by a spell your opponent controls, it's any spell. So if you got Gargos out, you can stick a Rancor on your creature, or Giant Growth your creature, whatever, anything to target your creature with a spell, and you could just fight through your opponent's entire team of blockers, smash your opponent with the Hydra. So I think Gargos, it is super sweet for like Hydra Tribal. This is a great, great Hydra commander, although there is one problem. And that is, it's mono green, and Hydra Tribal really wants to be at least Gruul, maybe even Teemer, to catch most of the best Hydras. So that's my worry about Gargos actually being your commander, is I don't know if you can build a very good Hydra deck being mono green. There are some good ones, but you're gonna miss out on a lot of the best Hydras. So maybe this is more like casual modern card, definitely something in your 99 if you're playing Hydra Tribal, and maybe you can make mono green Hydras work, although I do kind of wish it had some more colors in its mana cost, because that would make Gargos even better as a Hydra commander. But regardless, 4 off your Hydras is an insane deal, so it's super sweet, really powerful, in the right deck type of card. Next on our list, we got a weird one. Embodiment of Agonies. So a 3-mana 0/0 demon, but it enters the battlefield with a +1/+1 counter for each different mana cost among non-land cards in your graveyard. So this is a weird one. This is something I don't think we've ever cared about before, the different mana cost in your graveyard. So here's a quick example of what this means. Obviously, your Lightning Bolt and your Fatal Push and your Path to Exile, they have different mana costs. They're different colors. That's simple. But Embodiment actually does more than that. Embodiment cares about, like, the literal configuration of mana symbols on the top of your card. That's all it cares about. So, technically, Giralf's Messenger, Liliana the Veil, Dismember, they're all basically three mana black cards, but they all have different mana costs. Giralf's Messenger is triple black. Liliana is one colorless or generic and two black. Dismember, one colorless or generic into Phyrexian black. So if you had one of each of these in the graveyard, Embodiment is going to get a +1/+1 counter for each of those, which is actually powerful. Obviously, if you had like hybrid cards, it gets really crazy because those mana costs are insane and different than everything. So if you're willing to build around this, you can make it really big. In standard, you got to get things in your graveyard. We don't have a ton of super awesome ways, but like the Explorer package can work. That's a good way to get things in your graveyard. Tamio, maybe the best way. So if you just stock your graveyard, this can easily end up being a 5/5 Flying Death Touch for 3, a 6/6, a 10/10 Flying Death Touch for 3, if you can get cards in your graveyard. And because it deals with +1/+1 counters, there's some tricks. Like, there are some fringe synergies, more against the odd stuff, but like, it's a way to pump your Simic Ascendancy. You can proliferate more counters on it with Karn's Bastion or any proliferate stuff. It's a demon, so we're getting closer to the 4 demon for Liliana's contract. Like, they keep sneaking in, maybe, before rotation. We'll have a chance to win the game with Liliana's contract. And it gets even easier if you're playing in Modern. In Modern, it is so easy to stock your graveyard at Lightning Speed, Faithless Lootings, and Thought Scours, and just really simple. You can even play, like, Unearth to get back Embodiment of Agonies that you mill. So I can imagine this being very big in Modern, although there is bad news. There is bad news. We got to talk about it. And that is, Embodiment of Agonies, it's a 0/0. I really wish it was a 1/1 to begin with that then got counters on top of it, or even a 0/1. The problem is, if your opponent has graveyard hate, you kind of just can't cast Embodiment of Agonies. We got Leyline of the Void returning. It's already popular in Modern, but it's returning to Standard. Rest in Peace, Tormod's Crypt. So anything like this, where your opponent could just lock down your graveyard, means you literally cannot play an Embodiment of Agonies. And you might think, okay, this happens with Dredge sometimes. Sometimes they gotta like hard cast their Sinkweed Imp. It's not very good. The thing is, with Embodiment, you literally can't cast it. It will immediately die. So graveyard hate is a concern, and it makes this card a little bit risky, although if you could dodge the graveyard hate and build around it a bit, it could be incredibly big and scary and flying and death touching for just 3 mana. Next on our list, we got a fun one. Colossus Hammer, a really weird new equipment. So 1 mana equipment. Equipped creature gets +10/+10 and loses flying, and you equip it for 8. So obviously really cheap to come down, cheap hammer. On the other hand, it's really heavy to pick up. You gotta pay 8 to equip it. So heavy that you can't even fly if you're holding it. I guess it just weighs you down too much. So 8 to equip, that is kind of the killer part of this card. And that means you can't really just play it in a fair deck. There's no way, even for +10/+10, 8 mana is just too much. But there are some tricks to get around this. Probably the easiest is Sigarda's Aid. Sigarda's Aid, hilarious. 1 mana, when you cast an aura equipment, you can cast it like they have flash, and when an equipment comes into play under your control, you get to attach it to a creature you control. So let's say you play Sigarda's Aid on turn 1, maybe with, I don't know, Memnite, Ornithopter. Turn 2, Colossus Hammer, equip it for free, smash for 10, probably going to be able to win that game with a 10/10 attacking, at least, plus whatever power the creature has on turn 2. Quest for Holy Relic can also get it done if you can have 5 creatures enter play, maybe some sort of loopy, glint hawky, bouncing your own stuff type thing. But once you get there, you sack it, tutor it out, equip it. So those are easy ways to kind of build around Colossus Hammer. Basically just negate the equip cost, and then this card is insane. As far as more competitive decks, I think think what I'm most interested in here is actually the SROM Piercesteel deck in Modern. So, Claws' Hammer, the downside is it costs some mana. Costing mana, it's not ideal. The deck really wants free equipment for the combo, but one mana is not that much. And then you have Piercesteel Paladin, which is another way you can equip things for free as long as you have Metalcraft. And then Colossus Hammer, it gives you a backup plan for winning the game. It gives you a massive Piercesteel Paladin that you could just beat down with. So if for some reason your opponent has, I don't know, Leyline of Sanctity, so you can't grape shot them and win that way, normally the Piercesteel deck, the SROM deck, really struggles because it only really has one plan. Colossus Hammer, play it as like a one of maybe, and give yourself a backup plan where you just can beat down with a 12-12 SROM or Piercesteel Paladin. That's only a couple attacks to win the game. So I think that that might be a possibility. On the other hand, don't play it fairly. Please, 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 not in limited, not in standard, not in modern, not in your commander deck. If you can't cheat on the equip cost, this card is not playable. So not only is it so expensive that you're unlikely to be able to equip it anyway, but the risk is really high. So a really cool build around, if you can cheat on the equip cost, but not a card that you can play fairly because the normal equip cost is just way too high. Next up, we have a card from a couple of days ago that we somehow didn't talk about, Agent of Treachery. So 7 mana, 2/3. Not a great start, but as a sweet ability, when it enters a battlefield, gain control of target permanent, any permanent, and then at the beginning of your end step, if you control 3 or more permanents you don't own, you draw 3 cards. That is a lot of card draw if you can actually pull that off. So, Agent of Treachery, it seems like a card that is mostly of note because of Yarok and also Panharmonicon. If you could double this up, it is going to be insane. Stealing 2 figs for 7 mana, and then maybe if you get enough Yaroks and Panharmonicons, you steal 3 figs, start drawing 3 cards a turn, which that's going to put the game away super quick. So I want to play Agent of Treachery with one of my favorite cards, Panharmonicon or new Panharmonicon and Yarok. However, I think this card might be better than it looks. At 7 mana, it's only 1 more mana than Volition Reigns, which saw play in standard, something like in Bolas's Clutches, which hasn't seen much play in standard, and it comes with the upside that it's a creature, it has a body, and if it dies, you still get to keep the permanent. One of the downsides, like Volition Raids and Bolas's Clutches, your opponent mortifies it, they get back their thing, that's really brutal. So I think Agent of Treachery, it might have a chance in standard even. We already see like Mass Manipulation, Entrancing Melody being very heavily played. In a deck like that, you're going to turn on the later mode of Agent of Treachery really quickly, start drawing tons of cards, so it might be an option there. But even just yoinking one Planeswalker for 7 mana, that's a pretty sweet, pretty awesome deal. So I'm really hyped for this card. Also has some sweet potential in Commander. Decks like Rubinia Soulsinger, Kiga Tidalstar, Send Triplets. There are Commander decks that are basically built around stealing your opponent's permanents and getting them on your side of the battlefield. If that is the theme of your deck, Agent of Treachery auto-include. Like, not only does it work with the theme of stealing your opponent's stuff, but it's going to give you a source of card advantage, which is a really nice upside. And it might just be fine in Commander in general. 7 mana is kind of a lot, but unconditional stealing of any permanent is a very powerful effect. So I want to play this one with Panharmonicon. I think it's going to show up in certain Commander decks for sure, and it might be a card you can just play in any Commander deck or most Commander decks because it is actually very, very powerful. I really love this card. This is one of my new favorite Panharmonicon cards that we've had in a long, long time. Next up, we got Blood-Soaked Altar. Random uncommon. 6 mana artifact. You can pay 2 life. You gotta tap it as well. Discard a card and sack a creature, and you get a 5/5 black demon creature with flying for your work. Downside is you can only do it as a sorcery, which I think is what kills this card. I mean, it's 6 mana, so maybe it was killed anyway as far as seeing competitive play, but the fact you gotta do it as a sorcery means you can't, like, sacrifice one of your creatures in response to removal to make another creature. That said, if you want to take the Liliana's Contract challenge before rotation, this is another way to get a demon on the battlefield. Counts towards one of your 4 demons with different names. It's a demon token. Its name is Demon. So if you're trying to build Liliana's Contract, maybe it has a chance. Otherwise, maybe a limited card at best. We also got Ancestral Blade, and I gotta say, I love what Wizards is doing with equipment in Core Set 2020. We have been talking about how equipment haven't been playable in almost a decade now. Back to like New Phyrexia since we had a playable equipment, and Wizards They might have cheated a little bit around the edges by making them living weapons, essentially, but I think they found a way to make playable equipment. Ancestral Blade comes into play, and you create a 1-1 soldier and attach it to it. It costs you 2 mana, and the equipped creature gets +1/+1, and it's 1 to equip. So essentially, when this comes into play, you are going to get a 2-2. And then you have an equipment once your 2-2 dies. So essentially, this is Veteran Sidearm, which is not nearly anywhere close to being a playable card, except a Veteran Sidearm that actually makes a creature when it comes into play is a whole different story. I think the best comparison for this is probably Flare Husk. Flare Husk came into play with a 0/0 germ, gave the equipped creature +1/+1. It only costs 1 mana, but 2 to equip. Ancestral Blade is basically a Flare Husk, but instead of getting an Eager Cadet, you're getting a Grizzly Bear when it comes into play, and the jump from Eager Cadet to Grizzly Bear, and the upside of being less to equip, is really relevant. And Flare Husk, while it took like Artifact Matters type decks, it was a card that saw play in Standard, so I think that Ancestral Blade has a chance. It is close enough, having a creature come along with it, so it does something right away, goes a long way towards solving a lot of equipment's issues, so I think there's a chance this one shows up. It's probably going to take a soldier deck, an Artifact Matters type deck, some sort of specific deck. I don't think just normal white weenie will play it necessarily, but it looks enough like Flare Husk and close enough to a formerly playable card that it's worth keeping in mind for Standard play. We also got Sky Knight Vanguard. Basically, uncommon 2-mana Legion War boss. When it attacks, you get to create a 1-1 soldier that is tapped at attacking. It has flying, so you can get in with it easily. It does feel like a card that can spiral out of control in the right matchup. On the other hand, if your opponent has a blocker, you just kind of suicide that soldier into the blocker every turn, and it doesn't do anything. But worth bearing in mind, we also got Mystic Forge, and this one's kind of spicy. So, 4-mana artifact, you can look at the top card of your library, you can cast the top card of your library. If it's an artifact or colorless non-land card, and then you can tap it, pay a life, exile the top card of your library. So if you're fizzling, you can tap it once, get a new card on the top of your deck. So Mystic Forge, very much like an Experimental Frenzy or a Future Sight, allowing you to play the top card of your library. The problem is, the restriction on Mystic Forge is really huge. Way more than Experimental Frenzy. Future Sight doesn't even really have a restriction. The upside is, it's colorless, so you can play it in any deck, no questions asked. But the fact that you could only cast colorless non-land cards or artifact cards means you're going to need a really specific deck to make this work. So one possibility would be something like a Affinity in Modern, where you play your Ornithopters, Memnites, Mox Opals, most of your deck is colorless non-land cards anyway. You could also go really janky and build like Eldrazi. There are Devoid cards, which are technically colorless because of their horrible mechanic, but maybe cast an Emrakul off the top of your deck. That seems pretty sweet. The problem is, I feel like Experimental Frenzy could just do everything Mystic Forge does, except better. Experimental Frenzy lets you play at least one land each turn. Experimental Frenzy doesn't have the colorless slash artifact restriction. Yeah, you can't cast cards from your hand, but I think in like 99.9999% of decks, Experimental Frenzy is just gonna do what Mystic Forge does, but in a better way, a more consistent way. So I think that's a problem with Mystic Forge. If it wasn't for Experimental Frenzy, I would be thinking, okay, is there a way we can build like an Affinity artifact deck to take advantage of this? But since we have Experimental Frenzy, I'm thinking more along the lines of, maybe you just play Experimental Frenzy. How about I find a way to splash a single red mana symbol card in my deck, rather than having to deal with all the drawbacks and downsides of Mystic Forge? And can't overstate how big it is to not be able to play lands. Like, the way Experimental Frenzy fizzles is when you hit two lands in a turn. Well, Mystic Forge fizzles at your first land. Yeah, you could tap it once to get rid of the first land, I guess, but the fizzle rate is much, much higher than Experimental Frenzy, and that doesn't even include the massive restriction where you can't just cast any card. It's got to be a very specific and narrow subset of cards. So Mystic Forge, I'm pretty sure it's a bad and probably just unplayable Experimental Frenzy. Finally today, we have an entire parade of lower rarity stuff. There's a cycle of cards that care about cards with the same name, essentially. We've seen some of them before. Undead Servant, Fairy Miscreant. Fairy Miscreant, actually pretty good. If you're playing like Favorable Winds, maybe a Ninja deck in Modern could take advantage of it. Fairy Tribal. New ones include Pack Mastiff, 2-2 for 2, can pump all your Pack Mastiffs. Battalion Foot Soldier, basically a slow ground version version of Squadron Hawk, probably not actually going to be good enough. So I think Fairy Miscreant Reprint, main takeaway here. Otherwise, we got a ton of cards from the Planeswalker deck. So these are cards that you won't actually open in your core set 2020 boosters. Instead, if you buy one of the Planeswalker decks, these are the new cards that are coming along with a bunch of old cards as well. So from the Sora deck, you get a Swords Guide, a Tutor, and it's kind of basically the same. Like, the setup is basically the same. Every one of these decks has a 5-drop creature that tutors for the Planeswalker from the deck, along with some lower rarity stuff, none of which is especially standard playable. Thirsting Bloodlord, it is a Vampire Lord. It is 4 mana, doesn't have much upside. So mostly worth note that these cards exist. If you pick up any of the Planeswalker decks, you will be able to snag them. If you want to see the Planeswalker deck list, we have them all posted over on MTGGoldfish.com. So you can go and look. I will link the deck list article in the description of this video. So if you want to see everything that's coming in each and every one of the Planeswalker decks, that is your place to find out. Otherwise, a few other random commons and uncommons. I believe these are coming from the starter decks. Again, cards that aren't really playable. So anyway, I wanted to show those cards just so everyone knew they exist, but really not a whole lot to say about them other than they are Magic cards and you can get them in the Planeswalker decks or whatever. So anyway, I think that brings us to the end of our daily Core Set 2020 spoilers for today. So what do you think about all these new cards? How busted is Vivien? Can a Living Wish Planeswalker with aggroey mono green beatdown upside make it in standard? What about Cavalier of Winds? The card is powerful. Is it powerful enough to beat out all the card advantage Planeswalkers in standard? Have a spot in tier decks? What do you want to do with Gargos? Can you build Gargos Hydra Commander, or does being mono green make it too hard to play enough Hydras? Is it more a 99 card? What other sweet cool things can we do with it in Unbound Flourishing? How about Embodiment of Agonies? What mana cost can you get in your graveyard? How big can you make that by turn 3, by turn 4? Is it a legitimate card, or does the fact that it dies if there's graveyard hate and literally cannot be cast, does that make it too hard to build around? How about Colossal Hammer? Is it possible to build around our janky equipment giving something plus 10 plus 10? Agent of Treachery, can we play that with Panarmonic on Blood Soaked Altar? Can that make Liliana's Contract a thing? Ancestral Blade, is our new Flare Husk gonna make it? What about Mystic Forge? Am I underrated it, calling it a bad version of Experimental Frenzy? Am I missing something about it? All the lower rarity stuff, the Planeswalker deck cards, let me know in the comments. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you all enjoyed the video, and I will talk to you soon. Thanks for watching the video. If you enjoyed it, help us out by clicking that like button down below. And to keep up on all the latest and greatest, click that subscribe button. And don't forget to hit that bell icon to get alerts whenever we have new videos. And if you want to, check out some of our other sweet videos here and here.